Good morning. Let's begin our service by singing hymn number 48. Dear Father, Mother, Thou dost grant all good and perfect gifts to me. 'Tis mine to raise this beacon here, obedience unto Thee. Hymn number 48. Scriptural will be given by Wendy from South Carolina.
The Holy Bible, 1 John. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. And we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. Who is he that overcometh the world, but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? For there are three that bear record in heaven: the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. And these three are one. And we know that the Son of God is come, and hath given us an understanding, that we may know him that is true, and we are in him that is true, even in his Son Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life.
Let us now have a moment of silent prayer and follow with the Lord's Prayer and its spiritual interpretation as given in the Christian Science textbook.
Our Father, who which art in heaven.
Our Father, Mother God, all harmonious.
Hallowed be thy name.
Adorable One,
thy kingdom come.
Thy kingdom is come. Thou art ever present.
Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven.
Enable us to know, as in heaven, so on earth, God is omnipotent, supreme.
Give us this day our daily bread.
Give us grace for today. Feed the famished affections.
And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors.
And love is reflected in love.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
And God leadeth us not into temptation, but delivereth us from sin, disease, and death.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever.
For God is infinite, all power, all life, truth, love, over all and all. Now let's sing hymn number 391. Why search the future and the past? Why do ye look with tearful eyes and seek far off for paradise? Before your feet life's pearl is cast. Hymn number 391.
Thank you.
welcome to the Sunday morning service of the Plainfield Christian Science Church Independent. We begin every Sunday morning here at 10 a.m. with our roundtable discussion, where we discuss this week's lesson and other topics that need to be covered, and learn how to practice better in our daily lives Christian Science. And we had another really good one this morning. So if you missed it, or if you'd like to hear it again, you can find it on our website, plainfieldcs.com. And you can also find it on our YouTube channel and our Vimeo channel. We have a Sunday school for children that meets at 11 every Sunday. And that Sunday school is open to children anywhere. In fact, many of our students don't live in the area, but attend via telephone. The Sunday school has a dedicated teleconference number. And that means that if you don't live in the area and have a child of Sunday school age, you can call us, we'll give you the number, and our Sunday school teachers would be very happy to welcome your child to our Sunday school. We have a testimony meeting every Wednesday evening at 8:15, where you can hear testimonies of healings and lives transformed through the study and practice of Christian Science. And at all of our services and meetings, we have a nursery for infants and toddlers. So if you are in the area, you can bring the whole family. We have 17 different websites in 17 different languages. And as a result, the very finest Christian Science literature is available to people around the world, and in many cases, in their own language. Everything that we offer on our websites is free of charge. Doesn't cost you anything. You don't have to join anything. You are free to read, listen, download anything that is on any of our websites. Freely we have received, and freely we give. I'd like to point out an article that is now featured on our English language website that everyone needs to read if they haven't already. An article by William D. McCracken entitled, I Serve. Good explanation as to why we are here. And everyone is welcome here. And that includes all of you who are listening and participating from around the world. And now we will have the reading of a testimony of healing from the Christian Science textbook, which attests to the healing power obtained by studying the Christian Science textbook. And that reading will be given this morning by Mara from Mississippi.
Page 691, A Helpful Testimony. Words cannot express my gratitude to God for Christian Science. When I first read Science and Health, I had tried every remedy I had ever heard of. I felt no change in mind or body that I was conscious of until I read page 16 of the chapter on prayer in Science and Health. The words of the, quote, spiritual sense of the Lord's Prayer, end quote, telling of our Father, Mother, God, gave me a glimpse of heavenly light. I stopped and reasoned and remembered the teachings of Jesus. The truth of man's spiritual being dawned on my consciousness. I realized I was not subject to mortal laws as I had been taught all my life. I could not explain how I knew this, but I knew it. Through Christian Science, Mrs. Eddy had given me what I had longed for all my life, a mother, a perfect, quote, father, mother, God, end quote. I had known there was a great lack, and at that time, I believed the Orthodox world had, but half of the truth which Jesus came to establish. When I read, quote, "Give us this day our daily bread," end quote, and its spiritual interpretation, my tears began to flow. All the years of bitterness, hate, and fear melted away. I knew then, as I know now, that nothing satisfies but love. That day began the outward and inward conscious healing, mental and physical. There never came a doubt. I absolutely knew that Christian Science was and is the truth. Money, friends, materiality are nothing beside the conscious knowledge of God, man, and the universe. I did not need treatment from anyone. Science and health was so clear and beautiful. I could not understand the Bible before, but I found it illuminating now that I had a little understanding of Christian Science. For 10 years, I have not had to lie down in the daytime from any sickness. I am now and have been all these years the picture of perfect health. When I first read Science and Health, I weighed 104 pounds. I now weigh over 160. This physical health is not to be compared to my happiness, my harmony that nothing can take away because it is the gift of God. Nothing has shown me the perversity of the human mind more than in its conclusions in regard to my healing. Even when I felt and knew that I was healed, people constantly said, because I was thin and delicate looking, you are not well. Anyone could look at you and know it. Now that I am fleshy, they say, you don't look as if you ever had a pain in all your life. You could not have had consumption. When I think what my life was before I had Christian Science, of the 6 years of cold, sufferings, and coughing, not to mention the unhappiness, I had to, quote, work, watch, and pray, end quote, for the mind of Christ, that I may work rightly in God's vineyard, and to know that in truth, what belongs to one belongs to all, that one God, one life, truth, and love is all. ACL, Kansas City, Kansas.
The Bible and the Christian Science textbook are our only preachers. We shall now read scriptural texts and their correlative passages from our textbook. These comprise our sermon. The canonical writings, together with the word of our textbook, corroborating and explaining the Bible texts in their denominational, spiritual import and application to all ages, past, present, and future, constitute a sermon undivorced from truth, uncontaminated or fettered by human hypotheses, and authorized by Christ. And today's lesson sermon can be found on page 2 of the Independent Christian Science Quarterly. Subject, Unreality. The golden text is from Isaiah. Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? The responsive reading is from Romans. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit.
For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death.
For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace.
For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God.
The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God.
For I am persuaded that neither death death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come,
nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Fairley from Maryland will now read.
Exodus. And Moses said unto God, Who am I, that I should go unto Pharaoh, and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt? And the Lord said unto him, What is that in thine hand? And he said, A rod. And he said, Cast on the ground. And he cast it on the ground, and it became a serpent. And Moses fled before it. And the Lord said unto Moses, Put thine hand and take it by the tail. And he put forth his hand and caught it, and it became a rod in his hand. That they may believe that the Lord God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, hath appeared unto thee. And the Lord said furthermore unto him, Put now thine hand into thy bosom. And he put his hand into his bosom. And when he took it out, behold, his hand was leprous as snow. And he said, Put thine hand into thy bosom again. And he put his hand into his bosom again, and plucked it out of his bosom. And behold, it was turned again as his other flesh. And it shall come to pass, if they will not believe thee, neither hearken to the voice of the first sign, that they will believe the voice of the latter sign. Now therefore go, and I will be with thy mouth, and teach thee what thou shalt say. And the people believed, and when they heard that the Lord had visited the children of Israel, and that he had looked upon their affliction, then they bowed their heads and worshipped. I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. John. And the third day there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. And when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus saith unto him, They have no wine. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. His mother said unto the servants, Whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. Jesus saith unto them, Fill the water pots with water. And they filled them up to the brim. And he saith unto them, Draw out now, and bear unto the governor of the feast. And they bare it. When the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, and knew not whence it was, that the servants which drew the water knew the governor of the feast called the bridegroom, and saith unto him, Every man at the beginning has set forth good wine, and when men have well drunk, than that which is worse, but thou hast kept the good wine until now. The beginning of miracles did Jesus in Cana of Galilee, and manifested forth his glory, and his disciples believed on him. Matthew. When he was come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him, and behold, there came a leper and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus saith unto him, See thou tell no man, but go thy way, show thyself to the priest, and offer the gift that Moses commanded for a testimony unto them. And when Jesus was come into Peter's house, he saw his wife's mother laid and sick of a fever. And he touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she arose, ministered unto them. When the even was come, they brought unto him many that were possessed with devils, and he cast out the spirits with his word, and healed all that were sick. Now when Jesus saw great multitudes about him, he gave commandments to depart unto the other side. And behold, there arose a great tempest in the sea, insomuch that the ship was covered with the waves, and he was asleep. And his disciples came to him and awoke him, saying, Lord, save us, we perished! And he saith unto them, Why are ye fearful, O ye of little faith? Then he arose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. And Jesus answered and said unto them, Take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many, and ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all their things must come to pass. But the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places. Then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise, and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world, for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Romans. The carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then that are in the flesh cannot please God, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God.
Florence from Georgia will now read.
I will read correlative passages from the Christian Science textbook, Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures, by Mary Baker Eddy. Moses advanced a nation to the worship of God in spirit instead of matter, and illustrated the grand human capacities of being bestowed by immortal mind. The Hebrew lawgiver, slow of speech, despaired of making the people understand what should be revealed to him. When led by wisdom to cast down his rod, he saw it become a serpent. Moses fled before it, but wisdom bade him come back and handle the serpent, and then Moses' fear departed. In this incident was seen the actuality of science. Matter was shown to be a belief only. The serpent, evil, under wisdom's bidding, was destroyed through understanding divine science, and this proof was a staff upon which to lean. The illusion of Moses lost its power to alarm him when he discovered that what he apparently saw was really but a phase of mortal belief. It was scientifically demonstrated that leprosy was a creation of mortal mind and not a condition of matter. When Moses first put his hand into his bosom and drew it forth, white as snow, with the dread disease, and presently restored his hand to its natural condition by the same simple process. God had lessened Moses' fear by this proof in divine science, and the inward voice became to him the voice of God, which said, "It shall come to pass, if they will not believe thee, neither hearken to the voice of the first sign, that they will believe the voice of the latter sign." And so it was in the coming century, when the science of being was demonstrated by Jesus, who showed his students the power of mind by changing water into wine, and taught them how to handle serpents unharmed, to heal the sick and cast out evil, in proof of the supremacy of mind. We are sometimes led to believe that darkness is as real as light, but science affirms darkness to be only a mortal sense of the absence of light, at the coming of which darkness loses the appearance of reality. So sin and sorrow, disease and death are the suppositional absence of life, God, and flee as phantoms of error before truth and love. Christianity, as Jesus taught it, was not a creed, nor a system of ceremonies, nor a special gift from a ritualistic Jehovah, but it was the demonstration of divine love, casting out error and healing the sick, not merely in the name of Christ or truth, but in demonstration of truth, as must be the case in the cycle of divine light. Human philosophy has made God manlike. Christian science makes man godlike. The first is error, the latter is truth. Be fogged in error, the error of believing that matter can be intelligent for good or evil, we can catch clear glimpses of God only as the mist disperses, or as they melt into such thinness that we perceive the divine image in some word or deed, which indicates the true idea, the supremacy and reality of good, the nothingness and unreality of evil. The scriptures imply that God is all in all. From this it follows that nothing possesses reality nor existence except the divine mind and his ideas. The scriptures also declare that God is spirit. Therefore, in spirit, all is harmony, and there can be no discord. All is life, and there is no death. Everything in God's universe expresses him. God is not the creator of an evil mind. Indeed, evil is not mind. We must learn that evil is an awful deception, an unreality of existence. Evil is not supreme, good is not helpless, nor are the so-called laws of matter primary and the law of spirit secondary. Without this lesson, we lose sight of the perfect Father or the divine principle of man. Body is not first and soul last, nor is evil mightier than good. The science of being repudiates self-evident impossibilities, such as the amalgamation of truth and error in cause or effect. Science separates the tares and wheat in time of harvest. The science of mind disposes of all evil. Truth, God, is not the father of error. Sin, sickness, and death are to be classified as effects of error. To grasp the reality and order of being in its science, you must begin by reckoning God as the divine principle of all that really is. Spirit, life, truth, love combine as one and are the scriptural names for God. All substance, intelligence, wisdom, being, immortality, cause and effect belong to God. These are his attributes, the eternal manifestations of the infinite divine principle love. No wisdom is wise but his wisdom. No truth is true. No love is lovely. No life is life but the divine. No good is but the good God bestows. God is what the scriptures declare him to be. Life, truth, love. Spirit is divine principle, and divine principle is love, and love is mind, and mind is not both good and bad, for God is mind. Therefore, there is in reality one mind only, because there is one God. There is but one way to heaven, harmony, and Christ in divine science shows us this way. It is to know no other reality, to have no other consciousness of life than good, God and his reflection, and to rise superior to the so-called pain and pleasure of the senses. The one ego, the one mind or spirit called God, is infinite individuality, which supplies all form and comeliness, and which reflects reality and divinity in individual spiritual man and things. Suffering, sinning, dying beliefs are unreal. When divine science is universally understood, they will have no power over man. For man is immortal and lives by divine authority. The spiritual reality is the scientific fact in all things.
Let us now have a moment of silent prayer for our world. Let's now sing hymn number 208. The words of this hymn are by Mary Baker Eddy. O gentle presence, peace and joy and power, O life divine that owns each waiting hour, thou love that guards the nestling's faltering flight, keep thou my child on upward wing tonight. Hymn number 208.
Yellow, black, and white.
Let's now sing hymn number 199. Now thank we all our God with grateful hearts and voices, who wondrous things have done, in whom the world rejoices, who from the days of yore hath blessed us on our way with countless gifts of love, and still is ours today. Hymn number 199.
I will read from the Christian Science textbook, The Scientific Statement of Being and the Correlative Passages from 1 John 3rd chapter. There is no life, truth, intelligence nor substance in matter, or its infinite mind and its infinite manifestation. For God is all in all. Spirit is immortal truth. Matter is mortal error. Spirit is the real and eternal. Matter is the unreal and temporal. Spirit is God, and man is his image and likeness. Therefore, man is not material, he is spiritual. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because he knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man that has this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure. Psalm. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. Amen.